just later. So we are grateful that you are here today. So what we'd like you to do is, for those of you who are present, check into Facebook with your cell phones to let others know where you are, and then please mute your cell phones so that we can all enjoy this service today without any undue interruption. So Unity of London, we have a vision, and our vision is a world powerfully transformed through the growing movement of shared spiritual awakening. Shared spiritual awakening. So along with that vision, we also have a mission, which is co-creating with spirit to transform lives through that shared spiritual awakening. And so how do we do that? There are steps that we all can take. Most of you have heard these many times before, but for those of you who are new, we can create shared spiritual awakening by being a loving, inclusive, supportive community. So it's only, as the slide says, our egos, beliefs, and fears that separate us. We can be a loving community by promoting self-expression. And that is our true self-expression, our expression of self-love, of love for the world, our divine expression. At Unity of London, we have five basic principles. Well, the Unity movement worldwide has five basic principles. And so we can share our spiritual awakening by following those principles, knowing that there is only one God. God is. Knowing that we have a spark of divinity within us. We are. Knowing that we co-create our world with and our lives with the divine spirit. Knowing as well that we make that conscious connection with the divine spirit through prayer and meditation. And it's not just enough to know these five principles off by heart, but we need to live them as well. We need to share our divinity with the world. And we also can inspire people to make a positive difference. And that can be as simple as going to visit someone in the hospital or in a retirement or a nursing home. It can be visiting your neighbor that maybe you have heard is maybe not doing so well or would like a little company. It can be following up with that friend of yours that you've thought about and you've considered, oh, maybe we should get together, get caught up, go for lunch. Whatever it is, you can very simply, through your day-to-day activities, inspire people to make a positive difference in the world just by showing up and being your radiant self. And we also provide fellowship and education for spiritual seekers of all walks of life. So whoever is listening to this, whether you are live at 501 Nelson or online or yet to listen to it in the future, we are open to have you attend, to listen to be part of our community. Okay, so today we do have a couple of special announcements. Firstly, you can pray person to person with Sylvia, who is at 501 Nelson, or you can pray after the service with me by entering your prayer request or your desire to pray with me in the chat box, and then we will make that happen through a special Zoom connection. And today, there will be a very brief, and I stress brief, town hall update after the service. So as the slide says, when the service is finished, please stay seated, and our president, Lorraine, will come up and go through a couple of slides just to bring you up to date. And for those of you who are in London at Nelson Street, then there's going to be a barbecue afterwards. So I'm sure there's going to be wonderful food there. And that is a suggested love offering of $10 per person, or whatever you can contribute, if anything at all. Everyone is welcome. No one will be turned away. So Unity was founded on prayer over 130 years ago. And so there at the front of the sanctuary at 501 Nelson is the prayer box. So if there is anyone that you would like the prayer angels and chaplains to hold in prayer, just write their first name on the little bit of paper and put it in the prayer box. There's no need to provide any details about what the prayer is for, since Divine Spirit is all-knowing. The power of
washer, whatever was done to winterize it. I don't know if there's a cap on it or something.
Okay, if somebody on Zoom, please, has got their speaker on, can they please shut it off? Thank you.
Get that done before John moves.
Okay, can somebody, thank you. Okay, so let's just go into prayer now, please. So if you just like to close your eyes and let's just make that conscious connection to the divine spirit within. And let's just set aside all the busyness of the day. And as we go into this prayer, we bless everyone attending all spiritual gatherings, knowing that there are many paths to the one God. We bless all those watching online and those at home who are using this day to take care of themselves or their families.
We turned around the Collins yesterday. And yeah, a lot of
excuse
fun.
Me? Whoever is talking, please be quiet. Sorry, everyone. So today, we have an extra special blessing today. As I was informed earlier, that today is World Beatles Day. And so as we think of this happy music that we've just been hearing all morning, we know that we are blessed by all the creativity that is taking place in the world by our musicians, bringing us joy, bringing us peace, bringing us love. So we are blessed for all of the musicians, who are called to express their creativity, their love, their joy, their peace through music and song, including Pharrell Williams, who sang our first song, and also the Beatles, who have first came to America almost 60 years ago, and their music is still inspiring people. So we bless today, especially all of the people who make music for us that we can enjoy. And if we are musicians ourselves, may we take joy in knowing that we can bring happiness to other people as well. And so we take this opportunity right now to hold anyone that you wish in blessings and prayer and to speak their names quietly into this space. And so as we move forth into the day, we understand and affirm that I am one with all that is. And so it is, and so we let it be. And so this month, we also hold in prayer Unity Center of Winnipeg in Winnipeg, Manitoba, and Unity Center of Truth in Etobicoke, Ontario. And so today we welcome our platform assistant, Nancy, for the reading of the daily word and the introduction of our speaker.
Well, for those that are here at Unity at Nelson, we certainly saw joy in the introduction with the happy dance. And that's today's daily word theme, joy. I am blessed with indwelling joy. In John's gospel, Jesus prays his disciples and all who receive their message that they will experience for themselves the joy he knows. I share in Jesus's joy as I remember I am a living expression of the divine, created in God's image and likeness, just as Jesus was. My ability to express love, life, wisdom, and all other qualities of God is limited only by my willingness to live from my spiritual nature. I am one with God, and one in the allness of God with all people everywhere. The joy Jesus described remains with me no matter what is happening around. I know wholeness in the midst of illness, abundance amid the appearance of lack. Even sadness in the aftermath of loss cannot overtake my joy. From John 15:11, I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. Okay, our speaker is Tony. He likes the bus stop. Tony Orvidas is a lifelong student and teacher of spirituality, metaphysics, and abundance manifestation, an experienced mentor, speaker, and trainer, and author of Using the Law of Attraction. Tony has been an active member of Unity since 2012 and is a past president of the board of directors. So today, we're going to the bus stop again, and we welcome you, Tony Orvidas.
Thank you very much, Nancy, and good morning, Unity of London. Can you hear me okay? I don't know about you, but my favorite Beatle, since we're on the subject, was always Ringo Starr, because I always found he had a terrific sense of humor compared to the others. But today, my message is, as was mentioned, bust up conversation 3. This morning, I'll continue speaking about my topic from the last couple of months, about your soul's embodiment and about how you have created the life that you now lead. I'll also touch on the subject of stand-ins. And as I asked you when I spoke to you last time, please keep an open mind, stretch your belief muscles, consider new ideas, just go with the flow. Take what you need, leave the rest, no offense intended. So let's quickly review the basics of what I shared during my last couple of messages, much of which was derived from the books by Dr. Sue Mortimer and Kimmy Rose. Imagine yourself as the divine spirit at a cosmic bus stop where you and others pause between trips to this physical plane. As you wait, you get to chatting with other souls at the stop, and you're talking about your plans and agendas for life on Earth. You speak about what you desire to learn, how you wish to grow, what you'd like to experience, as a means of revealing to yourself your own true divine nature as a being of energy and the creator of your own life. You then make soul agreements or soul contracts with the other entities at the bus stop to help you achieve your purpose this time round and to help them achieve theirs. And you then get on the celestial bus to Mother Earth to be born into a mortal body, to incarnate, to embody as a bipedal human being. Now, according to Kimmy and to Sue, we are all connected. We're all one. Actually, Nancy read in Daily Word, we are one with the source and one with all people everywhere. So it's important to recognize that becoming one with others allows us to fulfill one another's agreements. And when we fulfill these agreements, we feel awake, waking up from our waking dream, from our illusions, which we believe are our reality. And it results in connecting collectively with others. We become compassionate towards others, and ultimately we see them as ourselves. We are mirrors to one another, each living in a world that is not only of a physical nature, but also spiritual. We begin to recognize we are here to help each other through the learnings. We realize that even just for a moment, the people we encounter play a special role in our waking up. We realize there is no such thing as victimhood. Now, seeing yourself as a creator and stepping into your true nature as the soulful self doesn't mean that what happens to you isn't difficult or that you don't experience some painful emotions over it. When you see your life from the perspective of its creator and recognize how you are served by what has happened in it, you discover that you don't need to engage in unnecessary suffering on top of the pain. You no longer take what happened personally to mean something negative or limiting about yourself, others, the world. Simply choosing to believe in the bus stop and in your incarnation helps you to put your experiences, both the painful and the joyous, in the most empowering context possible and frees you to move forward in the most positive way. Ram Dass, born Richard Alpert, was an American spiritual teacher, guru of modern yoga, psychologist, writer. In an interview published in Unity magazine shortly before his death, he shared an interesting perspective on incarnation. This is what he said, and I quote, "I have a puja table with all of the saints and Donald Trump. I love all the saints. I love Anandamaya Ma, Jesus, Buddha. Well, Donald, now I'm identified with my soul, and a soul sees other people as souls. Souls love each other. I look at the picture of Donald Trump, and I see the soul. I realize I have compassion for that soul because he's got a hard incarnation, such karma. He's acting out motives that are from past lives. Your true soul is a being of light. The soul doesn't comply with time, with space. It just is. When you're dying and going into soul land and the bardo, the in-between state, Ram Dass says, you meet your soul pod, a collection of souls gathered together in consciousness. Your soul pod's been traveling with you since it all began. The soul pod asks what you learned from your incarnation. Then there's another being of light, your guru, your angel, or whatever it is for you. You and your guru contemplate the choices for your next incarnation, including the choices that would lessen your karma. And then the two of you push the button, and all of a sudden, you embody again. Interesting guy, that Ram Dass, eh? Here's a bit of a side note during Pride Month. According to Reverend Maggie Whitehouse, who writes for the aforementioned Unity magazine, in each incarnation, we have a specific gender, but our soul itself is androgynous. Many traditions teach that a soul does have a gender, but this may be because we have one preferred sex into which we choose to incarnate most often. Perhaps the modern acceptance of homosexuality and transgender issues are all part of our deep yearning to return to our source, part of the next important step in humanity's growth. And we have a long way to go, she says. Would you agree? Annie McSmilitz was an author, spiritual leader, and an early organizer of the New Thought movement, of which Unity is part. In her book, Generation and Regeneration, she talks about rebirth, pre-birth. By birth, she writes, we leave the pre-existent state to which most of us are strangers. That is, we do not remember what has taken place before we were born. And this memory cannot be restored until at least a measure of our attachment to this present state has been removed. Some children, when they are born, bring in memories of what they were in a pre-existent state, but for the most part, these memories are lost. As soon as we are born, we have new relations and new surroundings that we have not had before, she wrote. We enter into new creations, into a new plane where everything is quite, quite different. On the part of most people, the causes of their entrance into this earth plane by birth were namely the desire for certain new experiences, a new knowledge, a seeking for satisfaction in companionship, an assurance of a rounded or perfect life, curiosity, passion. It's no new teaching that we have existed before. If one can accept the pre-existent idea, even theoretically for a while, many things can be explained that have hitherto been dark, she advised us. We are immortal, which means without beginning as well as without end. Therefore, we have existed before birth as well as we shall continue after the appearance called death. Kind of neat how she makes it all fit, eh? Okay, I'd like now to talk to you about a related and rather unusual subject, stand-ins, or what many call walk-ins. And to be honest, I'm not sure if I really believe in them, but the topic is certainly worth exploring. Much of this information, by the way, is from a website called Reality Shifting. Now, a stand or a walk-in is a soul that takes the place of someone who has reincarnated It's where a new soul incarnates into the body of another soul who's ready to leave. Contrary to what some people believe, walk-ins are not forced to take the place of the person who has reincarnated. Both souls make an agreement to switch places. This is almost always done without the mortal body's conscious awareness or understanding. All incoming stand-ins operate under the veil of forgetfulness. If you remember from my message last month, the veil is basically a sort of shield that, when you reincarnate here on Earth, conceals all the things your divine self has been through, your past lives, your soul origins, and the like. Now, a soul who lived life in a body since birth may decide to leave before its body's physical death for a variety of reasons. Realizes it's not ready to experience the things that it had planned in this lifetime and needs more time to reevaluate the life plan. Its contract with other souls may be nullified if something happened to the other souls. For example, in cases where a soul made a contract with other souls who are meant to be their parents, but after some time, usually a few weeks or a month or two after birth, the soul finds that the parents are misaligned with the agreements within the contract, and the contract falls apart. Maybe it's completed its mission on Earth and has no need to stay here any longer. Or perhaps it does not want to live out its entire life contract in its original physical body. It therefore chooses to reincarnate to another reality in order to get on with its soul growth and gain new experiences. Now, why would a soul want to be a walk-in? Well, a soul may take another's place here on Earth for a variety of reasons. To fulfill a soul contract between itself and other souls here, to clear its karmic debt through lessons that it will learn here, to learn from the previous incarnator's mistakes, gather information, use it for its own path to evolution, to gain experiences in a completely new lifetime to aid its soul's growth and development. From a general perspective, the point of having a stand-in is for your soul to be able to leave without having to wait for your body to die. It's safer to have a stand-in because if the body dies, this could affect the life plan and soul evolution of the people who you formed soul contracts with, your parents, kids, partner, other soulmates, and so forth. It's a decision made between the reincarnated soul and the potential stand-in. As a stand-in, it's easier to switch places with a soul that occupies an existing body, so you don't have to start life on Earth from scratch. Now, it's important to note that the stand-in gains the personality and memories that are contained within the body into which it incarnates. An interesting concept, eh? My wife Bonnie's and my youngest daughter was quite a stubborn, loud, and headstrong baby, like a little tank, with hair that stuck up and out on the top of its head. A bit punk-like. That's not really her, by the way. Overnight, when still a toddler, her personality seemed to change. She became quieter, more pleasant and mild, and her hair suddenly flattened out. I recall Bonnie and me looking at each other and saying, "What happened? Are we now raising a walk-in?" Mike Dooley, one of the leading metaphysical authors of our time, in his little book, A Beginner's Guide to the Universe, Uncommon Ideas for Living an Unusually Happy Life, writes about our lives being a series of relationships in which we are constantly built up and then torn down over and over. And that in the end, we find that it was we, ourselves, who actually did the building and the tearing. Others, of course, will have a role given to us to assist us in our going construction and destruction. And conversely, we will be granted roles in helping to shape the lives of others. Now understand that no one can come into our lives who is not pre-approved, he says. There are probable actions and behaviors known in advance of wherever your paths may cross. Which is to say that while you're the ultimate authority of what happens in your life, it will be affected by who you draw or allow into your adventure. and what behaviors you help to elicit from them through your own thoughts, words, and actions. Sounds complicated, but it's not, says Mike. All you need to take from this is that those people in your life are on board with your manifestations and lessons, present and future, just as you are for theirs. True teammates, love bound. However you may fumble or offend, your needs, fears, and passions intertwined, compatible, complementary, interconnected. You will persistently desire to have certain people appear in or disappear from your life, and to have them otherwise behave in certain preferable ways, and they will have similar wishes for you. Throughout, remember who you really are to each other, kindred spirits drawn together in the romantic adventure of life, fellow actors lost in the delusions of the play of life on this earth in order to learn what's true and real. To really live, Mike tells us, you must accept responsibility for everything that has ever happened to you, including your birth and those experiences that were seemingly thrust upon you. At first, they may seem unfair, to say the least. Yet life is an adventure into possibilities and experimentation. Everyone choosing to be alive at this early stage of our civilization's development made this choice, knowing that ugly things might happen. We also knew that we'd return home unscathed, even greater for the experience, eternity still calling no matter what had just happened in the fleeting imaginary illusions of time and space. By claiming responsibility for all things in your life, you reclaim your power. You no longer believe that others, fate, or a god decides what happens to you. You cease being a victim. You begin living on your own terms, Mike says. Now, you didn't choose this lifetime thinking it would be without challenges. You chose it in large part for the challenges you'd likely have. The path to enlightenment must include accepting full responsibility for your happiness and accepting full responsibility for your own unhappiness. It's one kind of victory to slay a beast, move a mountain, cross a chasm. It's another kind altogether to realize that the beast, the mountain, the chasm were of your own design. Mike Dooley tells you to accept that you choose to participate in whatever happened between you and someone else and thereby reclaim your power. See grouchy people as those who may have chosen a more challenging life than you. Understand that sometimes the person whose life looks easy actually has a very hard one, but they're really good at not dwelling on the past, living in the moment, having dreams for tomorrow, and rolling with the punches. According to Mike, prior to our incarnation into this world of illusions, we knew we were God particles, pure radiance and light. Actually, pretty amazing, in all of our glory, everywhere, at once showered in love and knowing it. Pure God, ourselves, just like we talk in unity. There's only one thing that could rival that, make it even better, exploding all possibilities into more possibilities, voluntarily losing ourselves to be here. On one condition, of course, our ultimate return to the source would be guaranteed. I'd like to end my message today with a final little quote from, guess who, Mike Dooley. You can be quite sure, given the infinite choices available at the time and your celestial connection with the divine, that long ago, when you carefully mapped out your present adventure into the jungles of time and space, the hills and valleys you'd likely traverse, the setbacks and advances you would likely encounter, the good, the bad, the ugly, and all the lives you would touch, when your planning was done and the big picture revealed, you burst into tears of joy, overwhelmed by its perfection, and who you'd become. To be continued next month. And now, my friends, let's go into meditation. The guided portion is based on a reading from the Daily Word. Sit back, relax, get comfortable. Close your eyes, take a deep breath in, and exhale slowly. Take just a moment to turn off the noise in your head, the activity around you. Relax and listen. Let my words be yours. I feel the basic rhythm in my body that resonates from a divine awareness that pulsates throughout all living beings. I find this pattern in the measure of my breath, in the cadence of my heartbeat. I quiet my mind and focus on the natural pulse of my body. I create vital breathing space, both literally and figuratively. I gently focus on inhaling and exhaling, allowing my body and my mind to instinctively relax. I feel my pulse, slow and steady. By noticing my body's rhythms, I relax into a state of deep peace. Throughout my entire being, I feel a sense of harmony, belonging, and comfort. As I continue to breathe, I become aware that Almighty Spirit is breathing through me and as me. Gradually come back to your world of earthly delights, secure in the knowledge that all is as it should be, as you co-created it, being one with the source. And so it is. Amen.
Well, Tony, thank you very much for part three at the bus stop. It's just so interesting. I really enjoyed this series a lot. And of course, today, when you were talking about responsibility, to me, that's a tough one to get, because boy, oh boy, it's so much easier in our lives if we can just blame someone else for the hard times or difficulties that we may be enduring. And sometimes to take responsibility for that is a really challenging thing to do. But certainly, as you mentioned, to be able to be out of that state of victimhood is a real blessing. So thanks again for another eye-opening message. And I'm looking forward to next month's, I think it's your final episode on this. So thank you so much.
Thank you for this day, Spirit. Thank you for this day. Thank you for this day, Spirit. Thank you for this day. This healing, this healing, this healing day. This healing, this healing, this healing day. Thank you for this day, Spirit. Thank you for this day. Thank you for this day. Thank you for my friends, Spirit. Thank you for my friends. Thank you for my friends, Spirit. Thank you for my friends. My wonderful, my wonderful friends. My wonderful, my wonderful friends. Now thank you for this day, Spirit. Thank you for this day. Thank you for this day.
So we just are grateful today, and we want to say thank you for all of the people that continue to support Unity of London so that we can fulfill our vision, our vision, and our mission in the world. So, of course, you can e-transfer, as the sign says, the slide says, your donation to Unity of London at hotmail.com. Or you can send checks, you can do whatever you want. So we are grateful for all of the people who contribute their time, talent, and their treasures to Unity of London. And so I see those lovely people collecting the offering right now. So in a minute, when they come up to the front, we will bless that offering, for which we are truly grateful, truly grateful. So thank you, Renee and Kate. And so together we say, divine love through me blesses and multiplies all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. Amen. And so now we'll do the prayer for protection. So the light of God surrounds me. I am the light. The love of God enfolds me. I am the love. The power of God protects me. I am the power. And the presence of God watches over me. I am the presence. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well. Yay, God. So now we're going to do, of course, do our peace song. So please return to your chairs after the peace song.